The whole gospel, going to the whole person, to this whole city, to the whole world. This weekend and this week, we're going to be focusing on the expansion of the ministry of the gospel, ultimately through the work of a church like Park Street Church and the people that they partner with around the world, the ministries that they are involved in. And to frame our thinking, both to encourage your involvement and to challenge you for maybe greater involvement, I'm just going to springboard off of that one phrase in Colossians chapter 1, verse 6. All over the world, the gospel is bearing fruit and growing. I work with a small international leadership development agency, Christian Ministry, and every year I have the amazing privilege of traveling into some of the places represented by these flags and other places and getting to meet with people who are many times the ultimate fruit of missionaries who went out in the 1800s or the 1700s or the 1900s, and now their work is bearing fruit and growing all over the world. I get to hear stories that in my own language don't get to appear any place on CNN. Stories that are under the radar because God is writing them, even if the world has not noticed yet. And I hope that I can encourage you with some of that, because this church has such a long legacy of involvement, you need to know the fruit that is being born in other parts of the world, but also to challenge us towards a greater sense of personal and family and household and church participation. Because you need to know, at least in my perspective, we live in what might be called the most exciting time in Christian history, outside of the time that Jesus actually walked the earth. Because as we gather here together on a weekend, this weekend from Friday in some countries to Saturday in other countries to Sundays in other countries, more than 2,000 languages have been used in the language of worship. Some in gigantic cathedrals, others in churches that meet outside under a tree. Some are meeting in basements, in secret under oppressive regimes. But all over the world, the gospel is bearing fruit and growing. As our Christian fellowship, you should understand that 70% of the Christians in the world, the Bible-believing, following Jesus Christians in the world, are in Africa, Asia, and Latin America. Several years ago, at my own home church of Grace Chapel, a young man came up. I thought he was an international student. His name was Isaac Oyibo. I said, Isaac, you must be from West Africa. I was guessing by his name. He said, yes, I'm from Nigeria. I said, why are you here? Are you an international student? No. He says, I said, why are you here then? Are you getting training with one of the computer companies? No. I said, why are you here? My church in Nigeria has sent me to America as a missionary. He said, we have seen your movies, and we know that your country needs missionaries. You see, it's the whole church taking the whole gospel to the whole world. So we're part of something awesome going on. Speaking of Nigeria, I was just there in September, and on my way back from the teaching venue, we were caught in traffic because one of the churches has a big camp, they call it, along the Ibadan-Lagos Road on the way to the airport. And on the first Friday night of the month, they called together a prayer meeting, an all-night prayer meeting, that hosts 500,000 people that come to this prayer meeting. And it actually accelerated my prayers, because as we were stuck in traffic, I was praying that I would make it to my flight. But the reality is, all over the world, I just got a newsletter from a fellow who's working in East Asia, specifically in China, that he was working with a ministry within China that's praying for 20,000 Chinese missionaries to be sent out across the Buddhist, Hindu, and Muslim world, 20,000 by the year 2030. All over the world. In my travels, I've met with Brazilians who are serving in Algeria, with Arabic-speaking Christians serving all across the Middle East and North Africa, with Filipina maids going from the Philippines, training as domestic workers so that they could go into the households of leaders in the Middle East and in other parts of the world, bearing witness to their faith in Jesus Christ to the children of those people. And of course, Africans planting churches here in the United States and Europe. And you might say, let's just celebrate. Amen. We should celebrate. But the work is not yet done. There are 2 billion souls on planet Earth who will never hear the message of the gospel that God has sent his son Jesus to die in the place of our sins so that we might have a relationship. They haven't even been invited to that relationship yet. And they won't be invited unless someone crosses a culture to go tell them. So the work is not yet done. The team might be bigger. It's not just North Americans going, but North Americans along with Africans, Asians, and Latin Americans. But the work is not yet done. There are people who really have not had any opportunity to hear about Jesus. A young woman at my home church came to me and she said she wanted to go to Mongolia as an English teacher. This is back now about 15 years ago when Mongolia was just opening up to the rest of the world. I said, why do you want to go to Mongolia? She said, I was watching a video and they were interviewing this man out in the rural areas of Mongolia, a herdsman, and they were talking to him about life in Mongolia just to introduce the viewer to culture there and the world there. And then they finally said, so can we ask you the question, what do you think about Jesus Christ? To which the man answered in his own language, Jesus Christ. Who is this person? I've never, ever heard that name before. And the young woman just said, that's why I decided to go. Because like Paul the Apostle, she was saying, I aspire to preach where Jesus is not known, where he's not already named. And if you add to that this idea of the whole person, that, you know, poverty is part of our gospel message, relieving poverty. Oppressed people are recipients of not just the good news for eternity, but we need to infuse into their lives a hope for the present by helping economically or in development areas. Human rights for women and children, that's a gospel issue for us to be involved in. People dying from preventable diseases. The work is immense. The gospel's going forward, but there's work yet to be done. And in the remaining moments that I have with you, I want to basically just say, here's what I observe about the gospel going forward in the world. Principles both out of the book of Acts as well as in the church today, that as the gospel goes forward, these are the areas that all of us are challenged to be involved in. If you want a quick summary, the gospel goes forward when God's people are praying. The gospel goes forward when God's people are living as witnesses. And the gospel goes forward when God's people are sacrificing. More on these things. The gospel goes forward when all of God's people are praying. I was in one nation one time, a very economically challenged situation, and I asked the fellow that I was with, why do you see so many more miracles in your country than we seem to see in our country? He said, it's easy. We're desperate. You call 911, we dial G-O-D. The only way our prayers are answered is, the only way our health crisis is answered is by going to God. We throw ourselves on God's mercy in prayer. Now, he wasn't criticizing 911. He was basically just saying, our circumstances cause us to be more desperate in prayer. And that's where the gospel gets going. The Holy Spirit gets poured out. In Acts chapter 1, verse 14, when they were together, Jesus having ascended into heaven, the Holy Spirit had not yet come, they were desperate. And it says they all joined together in prayer. In Acts 2:42, after Pentecost has broken out in a wild way, they devote themselves to community, to learning, and to prayer. In Acts 4:31, when they are oppressed and threatened by the religious authorities, their first response is to get together and to pray. And when they pray, the place where they're gathered is shaken, and they begin to speak the word of God with boldness. In short, prayer has always been at the foundation of God at work. And that's why we want to encourage prayer. We want to encourage all of us to be involved in global-oriented, local, cross-cultural, whatever it is, prayer. Because the task is simply too big for us. There's an interesting interchange of Jesus with his disciples in Matthew chapter 9. Jesus sees the crowds, And the description goes like this. Jesus saw the crowds, and he saw them as harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Now what Jesus is seeing is the needs of people. And then Jesus says to his disciples, the harvest is plentiful, meaning the work of spreading the gospel is out there, but there aren't enough laborers, there aren't enough workers. So the needs of people are obvious, harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd, and the need for people is obvious, laborers in the harvest. But the first thing Jesus says is pray that the Lord of the harvest will send forth laborers. Because brothers and sisters, if we try to respond to every need we hear about, our life will be so schizophrenic we won't have any impact anywhere. We need to go to the Lord of the harvest and say, Lord, where is my impact? Where's my household? Where is my family's impact in the world? Because the needs are so great. That's why we go to God in prayer. We go to God in prayer. Now, I'm a very simple-oriented person, and I like to help people think in terms of ways you can expand your prayers. So that's why I'm glad the flags are here. Because look around at these flags. Many of the flags are representative of countries that this church has partners in, and also they're representative of countries that this church has international students from. But maybe you want to choose a flag that just attracts your eye, and you say, well, I want to pray for that country. I want to pray for that country. I was talking with a 17-year-old young man up in New Hampshire, and I said, are you praying for a country? He says, every day I'm praying for Mozambique. That was pretty surprising. I didn't expect a 17-year-old to really even know that Mozambique was. Never mind, he was praying for it. I said, why did you choose Mozambique? He says, it's the only country of the world with a machine gun on the flag. It's true, it's right over there. Others have guns, but this one has a machine gun, reflective of their violent civil war past. You know, some flags have symbols of other world religions on their flags. That might be a way you get started. Maybe you get started just by praying for the people in your own community. You know that there are many people, internationals from all around the world, that are in your midst, and you start praying for their countries or for them by name. I remember Dr. J. Christie Wilson, my professor at Gordon Conwell Seminary. He said, when you see someone who's conspicuously from another world religion, pause right then and shoot up an arrow prayer, he called it. Because you might be praying for someone who's never been prayed for before in Jesus' name. I've never forgotten that. Any place I go, just to stop. Now, I'm not saying you don't buttonhole them and say, let me pray for you right now. That's just too weird. But basically, I'm talking about just remembering that these people are precious people and we pray for them. Because God does work through prayer. I don't know if you noticed it on the video, but they were talking about a Barnabas group. That's a prayer support group for one of the partners that's out. And a prayer support group is praying here in Boston. And a Muslim has a vision in Central Asia that leads him on a search that will become ultimately a relationship with Jesus. God works through our prayers. A number of years ago, my wife and I had a chance to visit with actually one of your partners, Stuart and Cynthia Foster. They actually have worked in Mozambique. When you saw on the video, the Lomwe have Isaiah and another passage in their language. That's their work. They've dedicated their adult lives basically to the Lomwe people of Mozambique. We went to visit them in the mid-80s, just at the end of a very long and destructive civil war. And we said to Stuart and Cynthia, when we go back home, what do you want us to tell the church? And they immediately said, tell the church 2 Corinthians 1, 10 and 11. Now, I don't know if you know all your verses by heart. I didn't know this verse. I had to look it up. In 2 Corinthians 1, 10 and 11, Paul the Apostle talks about all of his difficulties. And he says, but God will deliver us, Corinthians, as you help us by your prayers. Do you know what that means? When you prick up that church calendar with all the pictures of your partners around the world, those people are out serving someplace that you and I haven't gone, and they're saying God will deliver us as Park Street Church family helps us by their prayers. Choose a missionary partner or a country or an issue that you want to pray about. Start very simply. a flag or an individual, but learn about it and expand your global impact by praying. I may have shared this before at Park Street Church, but I'll say it again for those of you who didn't remember it or haven't been here before. I encourage you today to start expanding your global praying by praying for the country on the label of your clothes. You know what I'm talking about? I'm not talking about irregular. That's not a country. I'm talking about the place where your clothes were made. Because many of us maybe will never touch the Hindu, Buddhist, or Muslim world. But I guarantee you the Hindu, Buddhist, and Muslim world is touching you right now. And that may get you motivated to get involved in things like economic development to make sure they're coming from just places where the clothes are being made. It may get you interested in the country. You may start praying for a country and start meeting international students from that country because that's the way God works. A lady came to me at another church and she said, "That was an awesome idea." I said, "Why?" She goes, "I homeschool my kids. I have a 7-year-old boy, a 9-year-old boy. I can't get them to learn world geography. But I said, would you at least be willing to study the countries where our clothes were made?" The boy said, "Sure, fine." Probably thinking it was going to be Canada, USA, Mexico. She said, we went in and started taking clothes off the hanger and writing it down. She said, China was there, world's largest country. India was there, world's largest Hindu country, second largest Muslim country. Indonesia, the world's largest Muslim country, is there. Sri Lanka, Buddhist and Hindu country. Thailand, Buddhist country. All of these countries were in their closet. She said, 26 nations were hanging in one closet. To which I responded, that's what Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount, you know. When you pray, go into your closet. I don't think that's what he meant. He might have been foreshadowing globalization, but I don't think so. But seriously, to get together, nothing encourages one of your partners more than to have you come to them and say, I'm committing myself to praying for you every day. The gospel goes forward when God's people pray. The gospel goes forward when God's people live as witnesses. This is true ever since the book of Acts. You know, in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, he says, you're going to receive power after the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, the place you live, in Judea, the region that's around you, but maybe similar culture, in Samaria, the people that are geographically close to you, but you have to cross a culture to meet them, and to the ends of the earth. And the book of Acts is about that rippling spread of the gospel from the Jews to the Judea to Samaria to the ends of the earth. And Jesus calls us to live as witnesses, the whole person, the whole city, the whole world. In Acts chapter 4, they're threatened. And in the face of persecution, they say to the religious leaders, we cannot stop speaking of what we have seen and heard. They are so fired up about Jesus, they just can't start talking about it. And I got a renewed sense of what this means in the last 2 weeks living here in Boston. Because there were people who could not stop speaking of what they had seen and heard. I'm not talking about Jesus. What do you think I'm talking about? You know, it's just a momentary conversation. Oh, what about that obstruction call? How about the pickoff on first base? What about the grand slam home run? I mean, people that don't even know baseball were talking about it. Mayor Menino was talking about hoping that they would bring back the World Series Cup. That's hockey. That's not even baseball. The World Series doesn't have a cup, you know? But he was just so excited about it. And it really made me ask the question, where's my relationship with Jesus? Am I in a position where I would say, I just can't stop speaking about what I've seen and heard? You see, the starting point of being an effective witness is to have something to witness about. Disciples were dedicated to sharing. And you know what's encouraging to me? When I think about the global church around the world, Jesus has not called us to be lawyer, judge, jury, and executioner. He's called us to be witnesses. He is building his story in the world, and he calls us in as witnesses. And when we realize that, we realize my witness might be teaching English as a second language to someone who comes from a country that's never heard about Jesus, but I'm building the bridge. My witness might be reaching out and having international students come to my house for Thanksgiving so that they can celebrate what we celebrate. You know, my witness might be reaching out to someone who's in poverty and living on Boston Common. We are witnesses both with word and with deed. And having lived in this area all my life, I believe there are many people in this area who need to see the gospel before they listen to it. So that's why we are involved in things like helping immigrants get their documentations in place, or reaching out to those that are poor, or basically just changing the way we look at our ministry in the world. Somebody else called it 24/7 availability. That we're witnesses in our jobs, in our neighborhoods, in our apartment complex, in the people we stand with on the bus, in the airport, in my case. I was there about 6 weeks after the marathon bombing. And I was standing in Terminal A, going on Delta Airlines, I think it was, and there's a little kiosk there. There's a lady there, and she has the hijab that is conspicuously from Muslim faith. She's all by herself, just sort of standing there. So the first thing I did, I remember Dr. Wilson's admonition, pray for the people. So I prayed for her. But then I sensed the Lord was just saying, just go greet her. So I went over, and I know like three phrases in Arabic. So I said to her, salam alaikum, which means peace be to you. She was so excited. She said, nobody has spoken to me in 6 weeks. Why? Well, because we had categorized her. We had stereotyped her. Now, I'd love to tell you that we talked together and she prayed to receive Jesus and now she's planting a church. That didn't happen. You know, she just knew there was somebody who reached out to her. And I just entrusted her to Jesus. But being a witness is living the Christ life in front of people. And that might be cross-culturally when you get sent out as one of the partners, or it might be where you go back to if you're an international student. But mostly it's right where you are right now. In the month of March, I'll be visiting a church very similar to Park Street Church in Melbourne, Australia. And their church has determined that their primary witness is to international students that come from all over Asia into this church. They are right across the street from the University of Melbourne. And so they have this, you know, big, big outreach and a lot of food and all these other things that just make people feel welcome. But their mission priority is to be witnesses to the people that God has brought into their midst. And by being witnesses to the people that God's brought into their midst, they now have sent out international students who are now followers of Jesus and going in to infiltrate governments, to permeate the business world, to influence the educational world, in countries where traditional-looking missionaries will never be allowed. But it sprang from the fact that every person in that church said, this is our witness. This is the world that we are touching. So open our eyes and see that world into which God has sent us. One last thought about that idea about being witnesses. I deeply appreciate, and you need to know, Stuart, I brag about your church all over the world, so please live up to this. About your willingness of the teaching English as a second language and your love for the international student community, right? And I was talking with a pastor in Toronto, one of the most international cities in the world, and he said, God called us to go to all the nations of the world. We didn't go. So now he's bringing all the nations of the world to us. So open your eyes and be Christ's witness. Every member praying, every member witness, and the gospel goes forward when every member is sacrificing. Back to the book of Acts for a second. When they use the word witness in the book of Acts, the Greek word is martyria, from which we get the word martyr. Because in those first few centuries of the Christian church, they knew full well that to witness to the reality of Jesus Christ could cost them their life, could cost them their livelihood, could cost them relationships, could cost them their house. And yet they went out as witnesses. They were so enamored with the reality that they were following the crucified Christ that when they were suffering, they went on their way rejoicing that they had been considered worthy to suffer shame for his name. It's significant that on a Mission Sunday, as you begin this week, we celebrate the Lord's Supper, because it reminds us of the fact of the cost of what it cost Jesus to bring and be the gospel for us. And it reminds us, exhorts us to live in the same way. When you look at those missionary partners and you pray for them wherever they might be located in the world, remember that they've given up something to go there. Grandparents have given up the right to see their grandchildren every holiday. Parents have given up the right to let their kids be fully in one culture or another, but raise them in a multicultural setting. Being Christ's witness can be costly. It might cost us socially. You start inviting internationals into your home, some of your neighbors might say, "What's going on?" You know, you start dedicating some of your legal practice to the defense of immigration rights. Some people might, "What?" And you end up, it's costing you. It takes time to serve the poor in Boston. It takes time to learn enough about another religion to have a conversation with someone from that religion. It takes time to build friendships. And it takes time to expand our prayers. But that's only one of the costs. This week, one of the sacrifices that you're going to be challenged to be involved in is the giving of increased support so that the people who are candidates and ready to go can go without encumbrance, without being hindered by the financial limitations. So you'll be asked to maybe give up something. Maybe your whole family will say, "Let's just not exchange Christmas presents." You know, or maybe you'll say, "We're going to give up this to do that." The phrase I like to use is, we've made a decision to live more simply that others may simply live. And maybe you'll make a decision along those lines. A sacrifice might mean that you change the way you look at your retirement years. You know, some of us have this American dream retirement in our minds, but Jesus might have something different for us. From my vantage point, the very first prototype missionary in the Bible was Abraham, called out when he was at least 75 years old. So the way I say it is this: if you're over 75, you've made the cut, God can't call you. But under 75, it could be that God calls you to go. Why? Because we're all in this together, making the sacrifices. And it might be, frankly, life-costing. Just recently, as I mentioned, I was teaching in Nigeria. And almost every one of the students in my class knows some Christians in the north who have died in the interreligious conflict there. You know, I was at a conference in 2010 in Cape Town, South Africa. I was talking with a man about the gospel going forward in Iran. Amazing things happening in Iran. Things that are way under the screen of CNN. And he says, "Would you like to meet an Iranian pastor right now?" I said, "Sure." So I went over and he introduced me to Farshid. Farshid had become a follower of Jesus about 5 or 7 years earlier. Now he had planted more than 50 small house churches of 5 and 10 people across Iran. And we were just celebrating and singing the praise of God for what's been done. And 2 months later, I got an email. Farshid and 35 others are now in prison. And Farshid is in prison to this moment. Because the gospel doesn't go forward with just lightheartedness. It's costing him. His young family grows up while he langers in prison. In Beijing, China, I was sitting at a church, obviously all in Mandarin, and I was with 4 young men who had become followers of Jesus through an English teaching program. And we were sitting there together, and the pastor was speaking, a very old man, maybe in his 80s, a little bit bent over and quiet, very, very quiet as he spoke. And at lunchtime, because I didn't understand a word, Christy and I, my wife and I asked, "This man who is preaching, was he a good preacher?" And the 4 young men, "Oh, he is a great preacher." And I was thinking to myself, he was kind of slow to me, but I said, "What do you mean he's a great preacher?" "He has spent many years in prison for being a Christian." In other words, they weren't talking about the quality of his intellect or the quality of his energy. His life was basically saying, "Friends, this Christian life is worth it." He's identified with Jesus in the sufferings. Now, many of us we're probably not going to be called to such threatening and death-defying type challenges. But to give extra finance, extra time, extra energy, to be people who are living more in prayer and as witnesses, that's a sacrifice to many of us. So this morning, be encouraged of what God's doing in the world, but also be aware that you are invited, I am invited, to join with what God's doing. The gospel goes forward when God's people expand their prayer impact, to pray daily, to pray for countries, to pray for leaders, to start each day even praying through the global news, to commit to witness, starting the day with the prayer, Lord, make me available to you. And then you go into your office or your laboratory or your neighborhood or your classroom, and you say, Lord, here I am. Make me your witness. And then you say, Lord, open my heart to sacrifice. May the reality of what you've done for me that we celebrate today at the Lord's Supper be my inspiration to be willing to lay down my privileges for the expansion of the kingdom of Christ. Let's pray. We're so grateful, Lord Jesus, to be born, to be living at a time like this, to be part of what you're doing, a huge multicultural, multilingual family all over the world. Lord, we celebrate that all over the world the gospel is going forward, and we invite you to empower us by your Spirit to fulfill the role that you have for us, because we come in Jesus' name. Amen.